stars. I am the main star. My co-star, my main supporting actor, my sidekick, the guy that writes songs with me and performs them. I don't know how many of you guys already know Beaker? Okay, how many of you don't know him? Okay, everybody give him a hand, because he's been dealing with airlines all day. He needs a little lifting up, I think. Do you guys know the song, I'm gonna sing, 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 and I'm gonna shout, 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 and I'm gonna sing, and I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. When the gates are open wide, I'm gonna sit at Jesus' side. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. Okay, how many of you know that? How many of you don't know it? You guys win. Okay, it's real easy. All you have to do is repeat after me. I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. You didn't do it. See, you must be one of the people that buy the ticket and then don't take the ride. You're here, you may as well sing, because we ain't going to go until you do. It's real simple. I'm going to sing, sing, sing. I'm going to. Good. Sing, sing, sing. Kind of like the jail. I'm going to shout, shout, shout. I'm going to sing. I'm going to shout. This is your basic Protestant thing, right? You got it? I'm going to sing. I'm going to shout. Praise the Lord. You got it? And then, here we go. When them gates are open wide, and it's not when those gates are open wide. That's for college graduates. It's for when them gates. Because, you know, how many of you are from Indiana, actually? Okay, I will let you in on a secret. I know about you people. Because I come from Indiana, too. When I was growing up, I always thought, you know, the Appalachian people were so dumb. Mostly because they really are. Anyway, I always thought hillbillies were really just bizarre people. And so I always kept it a big secret that my dad's family moved here from Harlan, Kentucky, of all places. His dad was a coal miner. And they're on their way up to Detroit to get better jobs in factories than what they could get in coal mines. And they ran out of gas near Richmond, which is how my dad and mom met and how I got here. So I was always, because my mom, you know, she's a good, you know, good Hoosier stock from way, way back, good Quaker family, the whole bit. And I was always real embarrassed about my dad's family until I started checking around and I found out that Indiana is almost entirely populated with hillbillies that ran out of gas on their way to Detroit to get jobs. So in honor of my home state and the state that is most of your home states, we will say, when them gates is open wide. Are you guys Quaker? Why do I feel like I'm at a meeting? Okay, when them gates are open wide, I'm going to sit at Jesus' side. Then I'm going to. Okay, you got it. Here we go. Well, I'm going to sing, 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 and I'm going to shout, shout, shout. And I'm going to sing, and I'm going to shout. When them gates are open wide, I'm going to sit at Jesus' side. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. Okay, second verse is a little bit different, but you'll catch on. I'll say the words and then you sing them. I'm gonna stand, well, I'm gonna stand on the love of God, on the love of God, God, God. Well, I'm gonna stand on the love of God, praise the Lord. When the gates are open wide, I'm gonna sit at Jesus' side. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. I ain't gonna run, well, I ain't gonna run. When it gets hard, when it hard, hard, well, I ain't gonna run. Hard, praise the Lord. When the gates are open wide, I'm gonna sit at Jesus' side. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. Okay, try this. We'll swing low, sweet chariot. For to carry me home, swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. I looked over Jordan and what did I see? Well, it was coming for to carry me home. There's a whole big band of angels and they're coming after me. Well, they're coming for to carry me home. So I'm gonna sing, 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 and I'm gonna shout, 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 and I'm gonna sing, and I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. When the gates arms are open wide. I'm gonna sit at Jesus' side. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. Try this. Well, when them saints go marching in, oh, when them saints go marching in, oh, Lord, I wanna be in that number. When them saints go marching in, well, I'm gonna sing, 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 and I'm gonna shout, 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 and I'm gonna sing. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. Okay, I'm gonna divide you into three groups. Now, you people in from here over to there, you're gonna be group A. So group A, put your hand up so that I know that you know who you are. Oh, very good. You guys are group A? Then you people here in the middle. C. You got it? Okay, now, we're going to start out with group A. They're going to sing a little solo. You know what you're going to sing? You're going to sing, I'm going to sing, 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 okay? And the rest of us are going to listen, and we're going to evaluate you. Here we go, ready? Are you getting excited? I can tell. Okay, one, two, three. Well, I'm going to sing. Okay, you keep singing that till you get really loud. Group B, you're gonna sing Swing Low. You got it? Okay, now you need to sing a little louder. You guys sing. Now when them sing. Okay, everybody on your part, real loud. Now, when them saints go marching in, oh Lord, I want to be in that number. Okay, all together now, I'm going to sing, 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 and I'm going to shout, 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 and I'm going to sing, and I'm going to shout, praise the Lord. When them gates are open wide, I'm gonna sit at Jesus' side. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. And when them gates are open wide, I'm gonna sit at Jesus' side. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. Okay, here's another song that we learned over in Hungary, and but it's, I think, pretty popular in this country. I don't know if you know it, but I'm not sure that we know it either, but we will try it. It goes, is it in G? Everything we do is in G, or else we just don't do it. It goes, Lord, I lift your name on high. Glad to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to a cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. How many of you guys know that? A lot of you. How many of you don't? Okay, you'll learn real quick. I know you're quick learners. The important part, the part that I most like, there's a tendency now in a lot of praise courses for us to talk about how we feel about God, which is all fine and dandy. I think it's good to feel good about God, but that's not what... that's not what really makes the difference in our lives. What really makes the difference is how God feels about us. C.S. Lewis was once
a guy said, they were talking, and C.S. Lewis said, well, what do you think the most important thing in the world is? And he said, well, I think what we think about God is the most important thing in the world. And Lewis said, well, I think you're on the right track, but I don't think that is exactly the most important thing in the world. The most important thing in the world is, what does God think of us? And I'll tell you what, if God did not love us, then all the warm feelings we could generate and all the deep devotion that we could stir up within ourselves wouldn't make one bit of difference. That there is no righteousness that we can conjure up of ourselves that is going to make us spiritually alive. The only reason that any of us have any hope of any real vital spirituality is because of the way that God feels about us. And if you have any questions about the way God feels about you, just go read the Gospels, because he's made it very clear in the person Christ how he feels about you. There's nothing God wants more than to love you and have you let him do that. And that's why the second half of this course is the part that I particularly like. I think it's great to have good feelings toward God, but I think that it is saving that God has good feelings towards us. So the second part of this song goes, you guys that know it, sing with me. It goes, you came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Okay, those of you who don't know it, just join in, you'll get it. Here we go. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Okay, the whole thing, let's try it. Lord, I lift your name on high. How I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life.
I'm so glad you're in my
life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
One more time on that chorus.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Okay, well, I think it's time to start. How about you? Okay. So Beaker's going to start us out here, and we'll get going. We're a little bit late now, so I feel good about it.
No, I feel like I'm like attached to something or something.
Okay. Can we turn out the lights? Will that like mess everything up on the TV thing? Yes or no? They're gonna dim the back ones. Okay. Can everybody see that board? Can you guys see that board? I'm gonna like duck down for a minute. And you know what? We can film this, but. I don't know if we have copyright permission or not, so we'll see what happens. guys may need to send bail money in a year or so. Okay. Cool. This is, I think, one of my all-time favorite books, period. It's called Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Day. And we, this will be participation story, okay? So you need to pretend that you're having a terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day. And just whenever we get to that part, yell it, scream it, cry it, do whatever you want, okay? So let's begin. I went to sleep with gum in my mouth. You know what? Would it help if, like, most of it was on the board? Yeah, okay. Let's, you know what? So far, this is just not working out, so my philosophy is, let's just go all the way back to the beginning. Okay. Can somebody help me? Because I don't know what to do. This is like stuck on here. It needs to be up higher. Oops. How's that?
Good.
Is that good? Okay, here we go. Hi, I'm Beaker, and Rich is somewhere, and we're going to do a retreat on what you want, what you need, what you settle for. And, and it is a terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day. Well, see, the thing is I forgot the book to be able to read it, and so the words are printed up there, so if I can't see, I don't know. Well, okay, here we go. I went to sleep with gum in my mouth, and now there's gum in my hair, and when I got out of bed this morning, I tripped on the skateboard, and by mistake, somebody changed the story. I could tell it was going to be a terrible, bad day. That's what I thought it was going to be, because at breakfast, Anthony found a Corvette Stingray car kit in his breakfast cereal box, and Nick found a junior undercover agent code ring in his breakfast cereal box. But my breakfast cereal box, all I found was breakfast cereal. I think I'll move to Australia, I said over and over and over again. On the way to school, Mrs. Gibson let Becky have a seat by the window. Audrey and Elliot got seats by the window, too. I said I was being scrunched. I said I was being smushed. I said if I didn't get a seat by the window, I thought I'd puke. I could tell it was going to be a terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day. That's what it was, because at school, Mrs. Dickens liked Paul's picture of the sailboat better than my picture of the invisible castle. At singing time, she said I sang too loud. At counting time, she said I left out 16. Who needs 16 anyway, I said. I could tell it was going to be a terrible. Come on, little more oomph on that, okay? I could tell because Paul said I wasn't his best friend anymore, and Philip said that I was. He said that Philip Parker was his next best friend, and that Albert Moyer was his third best friend, and that I was only his fourth best friend. I totally messed that up. I hope you sit on attack, I said to Paul. I hope the next time you get a double-decker strawberry ice cream cone, the ice cream part falls off and lands in Australia. There were two cupcakes in Philip Parker's lunch bag, and Albert got a Hershey bar with almonds, and Paul's mother, she gave him one of those jelly rolls with little coconut sprinkles on top.
Guess whose mom forgot to put in dessert? It was a terrible,
That's what it was, because I don't know what that is.
After school, we went to get shoes, and I wanted them really bad. I wanted to get red, blue ones with red stripes, but the shoe man said, we're all sold. Wait, this is the dentist. And while we were at the shoe store, the dentist showed up and said, you've got a cavity. Come back next week and I'll fix it. Next week I said, I'll be in Australia. On the way downstairs, the elevator door closed on my foot. And while we were waiting for my mom to get the car, Anthony made me fall where it was muddy. And then when I started crying because of the mud, Nick said I was a crybaby. And while I punched Nick for calling me a crybaby, mom came back, scolded me for being muddy, for crying, and for fighting. I could tell it was going to be a terrible, that's what it was. I told everybody that, and no one even answered. Then we went to the shoe store for the second time in the day. The shoe man said, we still don't have those, buddy. Get out of here. Then we went to pick up my dad out of his office, and he said I couldn't play with his copying machine, but I forgot. He said to watch out for the books on his desk, and I was as careful as I could be except for my elbow. He said, please don't fool around with my phone. I think I called Australia. My dad asked that we not pick him up anymore. It was a terrible,
horrible, no good, very bad
day. That's what it was. Because at dinner, there were lima beans. I hate limas. On TV, there was kissing. I hate kissing. My bath was too hot. I got soap in my eyes. And I had to wear my railroad train pajamas. I hate my railroad train pajamas. When I went to bed, Nick took back the pillow he said I could keep, and the Mickey Mouse nightlight burned out, and I bit my tongue. Cat wants to sleep with Anthony, not with me. It's been a terrible,
horrible, no good, very bad day.
My mom says some days are like that, even in Australia.
Give yourselves a hand. That was very good.
Just yesterday, I picked up from Kent Audio in Wichita, which is where we live. I picked up the new slides and everything, which you can see half of. So this is how we'll start out. Is just some response thing, and y'all just hold up your hand, and I'll call on you, and you can yell that out. Let's just say that I was magical, okay? That I had this. This is a new age thing. Let's take that back. Let's say I was God and I could give you anything you wanted, okay? I just had that power. What would you want? What do you want? First thing that comes in your head, don't think about it for long. Yes.
A new drum set.
A new drum set, yes. An airplane, okay?
$1 million,
okay? Muscle car? Okay, everybody knows what that is except me. I feel really stupid. Okay? Yeah. You want love? Okay. Peace. What do you want?
Two teenage daughters that behave.
Okay. Any two teenage, or just like your two? Okay. Great. Yeah. Perfect health. Okay. A computer. Come on, more. Yeah.
I want my three kids to grow up to know God.
Your three kids to know up to know God. Okay. Come on, you guys got stuff. You're just being embarrassed because you're kind of on TV. Okay, right. You know what? Can we do this? Can we zoom in on this guy over here? He's raising his hand. Are we getting a zoom? Here it comes. There we go. What do you want? Go, my child. Can we just follow him? Okay. Anybody else want anything? Yeah, what do you want? A new home. Okay. Yeah.
To take us to heaven.
To be taken to heaven. Okay. Yeah. Graduate right now, okay? Yeah. Your whole family to be saved, okay? Anything else? Yeah. Contentment. Okay, cool. Yeah. 4.0, okay? Out of 4.0? Okay. The school I go to, they grade on this 12-point thing. I still haven't figured out what my GPA is yet. But I guess 0.0 something. Yeah. What? You want to be thin. Okay. Anybody else? Not want to be thin, but have something other. Yes. You what? To have your youth group sing with Rich. Okay. The first word that came to my head was masochism. I don't know. I don't know why, but anybody else? Yeah. Turn the heat up. Okay. I feel like David Letterman. Hal, can we turn the heat up? You're serious? You're cold? Okay. Oh, you guys are all cold? Man, it's burning up here. Anybody else? Okay, cool. I would like to, there are some people, and you will hear, first, let's start this way. I don't have a Bible with me, and I do that for a specific reason. Because when my teaching parts, I'm not doing anything from the Bible, like, per se. It's from my study and Rich's study, and we've brought that together and formed this retreat. So I don't want you to think that anything that I'm saying is gospel truth. Feel free to question. Feel free to disagree. Do it somewhere else, but feel free to. Okay? Is that cool? Does that make sense? Now, I'm not saying that's not biblically based or anything like that. I'm just saying as I'm not doing anything expositorily, if that makes sense. We're going to use words like the world and the church and society and culture. And when we say the world, society, culture, we're talking about basically pop culture, which is what we're all a part of, whether you'd like to admit that or not. And pop culture is pretty hard to define in one small definition. The best definition I could think of is the mall. That is pop culture. If you can buy it there, it is. Okay? But it's influences, it's media, it's what we see, it's what we read, it's the way we're taught. All this is pop culture, and that, folks, does play a part in making us who we are, whether we want to admit that or not. For instance, y'all are wearing clothes. And I would imagine that you have your clothes for a specific reason. Just think for a moment how much your clothes say. It says who you are, and it says who you're not. Doesn't it? Think about your hair, about your earrings or lack of earrings, the car you drive. How many of y'all, we're in Indiana, and I have a 65 Chevy pickup truck. I love it. Could you, if we were just going to play a game and I said, imagine a 65 Chevy pickup truck. Well, I was going to say flying down the highway, but it doesn't really fly. Rattling down the highway. Okay? And you, first of all, if you're going to just take a wild guess, what kind of a person, male or female, inside driving? You would probably guess male. And, what would they be dressed like? Let's say you saw and it was like some guy in his 25. You might guess overalls, kind of cowboyish. Okay, now, if I said, if I said, let's guess what kind of music, you probably would not say Beethoven. That would be a total, wait a minute, that'd be really bizarre. Pop culture plays a big part in defining who we are and who we're not, and we're affected by it. I want to get that out at the beginning of this, okay? Now, let's go back to, we read this story, and we're going to tie this in. Alexander wanted a whole bunch of stuff, didn't he? And what made his terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day was basically and very simply the fact that he did not get what it was that he wanted. How many of y'all have ever had those kinds of days? You've had them, right? If you can think back, is a large part of it due to not getting what you want? Well, sure. Job satisfaction, a job, pay, your wife to kiss you and not slap you when you come home. What you can fill in the blank of whatever it is, and it comes out to that. Sometimes in the church, we are made to think that wanting something is bad. And I'd like to say I don't believe that that's so. I think God made us to want things. Okay? And when I say things, I mean it could be things could be people, could be relationships, it could be love from God. But God made us to want. All right? God also made us to need things. And I think what has happened is we have tossed needs and wants into a basket and it said it's all the same thing. So that when my wife, who I don't know if y'all, those of y'all that know me, I don't know. I got married like in August, so it's like really cool still. People tell me, you know, it won't be in a while. But anyway, we have this thing that we laugh because she'll say, I need a new pair of shoes. And like I keep my shoes in the room in this little white Target crate. I have four or five pairs of shoes that I keep in there. And the reason that they're just stuck in the room and kind of smelling the room up is because there's no room in the closet because of all her shoes. And I go, wait a minute, you need a new pair of shoes? No, the truth is you want a new pair of shoes. And that's okay to want them. But let's don't say you need them. What I'd like to do is do you guys, if I would say physiological, our physiological needs, which would be air, water, food, shelter, protection from the elements, okay? Outside of our physiological needs, what do you think it is that we need as people? Acceptance, okay? Yeah. Unconditional love. Peace of mind. Companionship. Okay, you guys raise your hands and then speak, and when I call, speak real loud so that everybody else can hear. Yeah. Forgiveness. Yeah. Work. That's an interesting one. Respect. Yeah. Safety. Okay. Yes. Hope. Anybody else? Yes. Compassion. Yes. Need to laugh? Okay. Is that like I'm not being funny enough or hurry this thing up, let us get out of here? Okay. Now, think about all the things that were just said and then think about a lot of the stuff that was said in the one thing. It's a bit different, isn't it? Nobody said, I think I need $1 million. Somebody may think that, but nobody had the guts enough to say it. Okay? If you want to do a great study, go back and read Genesis. It's really interesting. I think Genesis could be a psychology book, psychology text. I think psychology is really kind of, I hope there's no psychologist here. I think it's kind of goofy. All right? But when you go back and read Genesis, you just find out there's just little pieces in there that are so cool. And when you wrap all that stuff together about creation, you realize that, and if you're belonging to a church that believes that there actually was a creation, and I hope that you do, you look at that, you go, you know what? There is someone that has made me. And in the Word, through His Son on earth, He has said that He knows me, and He knows what I'm like. So wouldn't it make sense that the person that made us, the person that knows us, is going to know what we want and what we need best. Sometimes even better than what we may even think that we know. Does that make sense? let's go back to the world, the society, culture. I want to make 3 points, and then Rich is going to come up, and he's going to, finish up this session, take it from where I leave off, okay? But this, do you guys, is the culture thing making sense? Does that make sense to you? And man, it does affect us big time. Our culture lies to us. And there are 3 lies that I'd like to let you know, to let you in on, that they feed us. The first lie is this. It's to believe in yourself. It's absolutely 100% beyond a shadow of a doubt, a lie. To believe in yourself. The second lie that we're taught. Are you guys writing? Did you get the, is everybody, are you done writing? Okay. There is editing capabilities on this thing, right? Hal, somebody? Say yes. Cool. Okay. Maybe you can just edit me out of the whole thing. The second lie taught by the world is to be assertive. Believing in yourself, Rich will talk about. He's gonna maybe define that a bit. I'll say a little bit about asserting yourself. Do you guys know what I mean by? Does everybody know what I mean by assert? Do you know what I mean by asserting? Kinda. No. Yeah. Come here. Now, hurry up.
Get up here.
That's assertion. What I just did. Okay. It's kind of putting my will, what I want, over and beyond anything else. Okay? So there's assertion for you. The third thing, the third lie taught by the world is to be independent. Okay? Have you seen Rich? That's a pretty smooth segue so far, huh? Anybody seen Rich?
Come on in. You're late. You know, it's really warm up here. And I was just sitting back there. Y'all might want to scoot in a little closer to each other because it is chilly back there, isn't it? Ah, sorry, that's the way it goes. If you're really freezing, just come up here and sit on the stage. It's nice and toasty. Lights are amazing things. Three. Okay, let me ask you this. We just, for those of you who got here late, because you didn't bother to leave on time, I'm only giving you a hard time. Beaker's talked about the 3 lies. How many of you have heard someone say you must believe in yourself? How many of you have heard that? How many of you have been to a self-esteem seminar? Okay, let's pump up. How many of you think that you should believe in yourselves? This always cracks me up. You did the classic thing. No. How many of you do? How many of you think that believing in yourself is important? Because I want to talk to you guys. Why? Okay, he says if you don't believe in yourself, you won't be able to accomplish things. Yes. Okay, let me ask you this, because I think there might be a little bit of confusion about what we mean by belief. When you say, when you go to church and you say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, what does that mean? Faith, what does faith mean? When I say, when I say I believe in God, or when I say I believe in myself, what does believe in mean?
Trust. What else? Yes. You acknowledge your existence or his existence? Yes. Okay, we believe that what God says about himself is true. Generally, and this is the trick that we all play on ourselves. When we talk about I believe in something, we mean I believe. We don't normally merely believe that it exists. We don't normally, to say I believe in something normally goes beyond I accept its existence. Very few of us say, I believe in that tree. Most of us say, I see that tree. Oh, I know the tree that you're talking about. We don't say, oh yes, I believe in that. When we talk about believing in, it's a matter of putting our faith in. And just generally speaking, frequently it means in an ultimate kind of sense, my faith ultimately goes there. My challenge for the people who say they believe in themselves is this. Do you ever wake up with morning breath? Do you ever wake up with pillow head? I wake up every morning, I go to the mirror, and I say, you know what, if I wasn't a Christian, this is what I would have to put my faith in. And then I spend the next half hour hiding it, washing it away, combing it out, scrubbing it off, trying to do everything. If we really believe that we had the power to save ourselves, why would anybody ever wear makeup? If we really believe that we had the power that ultimately we could pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps, why in the world would anybody go to the bother to wear jewelry? Why would in the world would anybody go to the bother to color coordinate what they were wearing? If we really had faith in ourselves in an ultimate kind of way, we wouldn't do a lot of the things we do. We probably wouldn't go to the gym. I go to the gym. Everyone there is unbelievably vain, including myself. Vanity is the only thing that's keeping me alive. I would have had 10 heart attacks if it wasn't for vanity. I don't believe in myself, and I have a suspicion that a good many of us who think believe in ourselves really don't believe in ourselves, because if we really believed in ourselves, we would not have need of anything else. Believing in ourselves means we are our own salvation, that we are the power within us to raise ourselves up. We don't have that kind of power, folks. And you know what? I think that it's very liberating to learn that we don't have to put our faith in ourselves. One of the greatest moments of liberation in my life was when I finally realized that I was not the Savior. When I finally realized, you know what? I am not responsible for everyone's salvation. I am not responsible for the starving kids in India. I'm not responsible for the kid whose dad is a drunk down the street. I'm not God. I'm a mere human. There's something very liberating about having the weight of the world lifted off of me and put in its proper place. Because you know what? God is a lot stronger than I am. He can handle it a lot better. A lot of people say, if you don't have self-confidence, you can't do anything. And this is, I think, the big trick. It's kind of like people who say, if you don't have sex, you'll never be intimate with anybody. I kind of go, wow, Christ was really up a bad way then. Because I think Christ was very intimate with several people. But I don't believe he ever had sex. We've all been led to believe that if we're not sexually active, we're just not human. But that's just not the truth. We've all been led to believe that if we don't put our faith in ourselves, we're not going to accomplish anything. I don't think that's true either. Let me ask you this. When David stoned Goliath and then cut his head off, where did he say his faith was? Did he say, I'm going to cut your head off, I'm going to feed your flesh to the birds of the air because I know I can do it? Is that what David said? What did David say? Basically, what he said is what you're getting at, is that because there is a God, I will do this, so that you will know that God lives in heaven. His faith was not in himself. His faith was in God. David is a very interesting study. After you get done reading Genesis for Beaker, then read the story of David for me, because I think it's a great, great little history there. Our faith is not in ourselves. If our faith was in ourselves, we could never afford to fail. Who wants to go through a life where you never fail? What a drag. Perfection is boring, folks. People who are perfect are only perfect because they are nothing. Anyone who ever did anything messed up. I love the proverb. It's one of my favorite proverbs that says, and I can never get it straight. I've worked so hard at memorizing it. I have it written over my mirror. It goes, where the stall is empty, where there are many oxen, the stall is messy. No. Wrong again. Where the stall is empty, where there are no oxen, the stall is clean. But with many ox, there is much strength. Do you know what that means? How many of you grew up on a farm? Where there's life, there's mess. Where someone is living, they're going to make mistakes. One of the wonderful things about when we read the gospel, one of the wonderful things about the records that we have of the apostles is that they really did make mistakes, not only before Pentecost, but even after Pentecost, even after they were indwelled by the Holy Spirit. Peter still had hang-ups about Gentiles. He still made mistakes, and yet the wonderful thing is Peter's salvation was not based on his being perfect. Peter's salvation was not, his faith was not based on his perfect grasp of every doctrine and every truth in the world. Peter's faith was based on the reality of Jesus Christ and what he accomplished. Peter did not believe in himself, even though he had the courage to stand in front of huge crowds of people and preach the gospel. It wasn't because he had confidence in himself. It was because his faith was in God. We are told to believe in ourselves, and the end result of believing in yourself is you end up putting a lot of pressure on yourself because you've got to be worthy of that faith. The wonderful moment of freedom is when you can finally say, you know what? When I die, I will rot. When I die, they will put me in the ground, because if they don't, I will stink up the place so bad that people will be repulsed, and it will be better to be buried than to stink. Ultimately, that's what I amount to. Thank God that there is a God who is beyond me. Thank God there is goodness beyond my goodness. Thank God there is grace beyond the grace I am able to extend. Thank God there is life beyond my life. I believe that I will be resurrected, not because I will of myself have the power to pull myself out of the grave, but because I believe there is a God who loves me and who will raise me up, give me a new body. And man, I've got a great one picked out. Next life, I am going to be really good looking. The world says believe in yourself. The church teaches us to believe in God. Does that make sense to you now? It's really a funny thing that we've done this now for several years. We do it about twice a month. And it's amazing how similar your answers are in all the first questions, like what would you want if you could have anything, blah, 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 blah. Pretty much the same thing everywhere you go. When we get to what do you really think you need, blah, 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 blah. It's almost exactly the same everywhere we go. People agree with everything. The one thing that people really get uptight about in these seminars is when we go, you know what? The big problem, one big lie the world teaches is that we should believe in ourselves. The world says to believe in ourselves. The church says to believe in God. People freak out. People go, oh, you can't tell our kids not to believe in themselves. And we say, oh, why? And you know what? Sooner or later, they can't really tell you why you have to believe in yourself, except that if you don't, you will fail. And my thing is, wow. You know, you look at all that beautiful beadwork you see that was done by the Sioux people, and you look at it and you go, oh, that's beautiful. That's fabulous. And today it's very trendy and very popular to be great admirers of what is called Native American culture. And people say, look at the beauty that they did of this. You want to hear a very tragic thing? And what particularly bums me out is when feminists give this big spiel about how beautiful Indian culture was. These Indian women were so afraid that the spirits of the animals that their husbands had killed would come and cause deformities among their children, or kill their children, or possess them, or do evil things, that in order to gratify the spirit of the animal that had been killed, they would have to beautify its hide. So they would spend hours and hours, and they would eventually go blind from sewing and doing that beadwork because they were so afraid that a spirit was going to come and do bad things to their children if they didn't beautify its hide and gratify it. People, you work so hard to be perfect because you think you've got to have faith in yourselves, but you don't. And what appears, what we would be told is this great attempt at making people pull themselves up is nothing more than just getting people to hang on to their ankles. There's a big difference between pulling yourself up and just standing with your hands on your ankles. And that's about all you can do. If we are going to be lifted out of the mire that our lives might be in, it won't be because of our efforts. It will be because of what Christ accomplished and what he continues to accomplish through his Spirit in our lives. Our faith is not in ourselves. Thank God. I'm looking at you guys. I'm going, boy, are you lucky that you don't have to believe in yourselves. You are free to be just as ugly as you are. And it's no big deal. I think that every morning. I think that every night. And I find it very liberating. Second lie we're told is that we're supposed to assert ourselves. How many of you have ever heard someone say, you just need to be more assertive? Most of you are all, I just saw a great movie. I love movies. I have a real weakness for movies. Did you see Iron Will? You know, it's this great Walt Disney movie, beautifully shot, great animals in it, you know, and the bad guy is so evil. It's like Cruella de Vil. You know, all Disney bad guys are Cruella de Vils. And he's like got his whip out there and he's beating his dogs and everything. And in the end, he has this wonderful, comes this wonderful tragedy at the end. His dogs eat him. I love that. You know, because the night before, and the good guy, he's perfect. He rescues all these other people that he's competing with. He saves their lives. And he's Mr., you know, good looking, young, idealistic. He's Mr. Pure, Mr. Everything. And you just go, oh, I love him. He's the hero of the story. And I hate the bad guy. I'm so glad when his dogs eat him. The night before that, I had just gone to see Philadelphia, which was so confusing. I went, man, I really feel for this guy. I really feel for this guy. But on the other hand, I'm behind the whole agenda behind what this movie is saying. I'm not sure I want everyone to accept this is, I mean, so confusing. Real life is so confusing. That's why Disney makes a fortune, because his characters are really good or really bad. And the really good ones win, and the really bad ones are eaten by dogs. You know, very cozy, very comfortable. So, how in the world did I get on that? Be assertive. So this father, this really nice, you know, gentle-looking man who has all the answers, you know, he's the father figure, a real Ronald Reagan type, and he says, son, when you see what you want, you got to go out there and get it. Have you ever heard that? Anyone ever tell you that? Have you ever told anyone that? You know what? When you see what you want, you just got to go get it. This is a remarkable thing. And this isn't peculiar only to our culture. This is pretty much across the board. People think this in a lot of ways. And you know what? The more we pursue what we think we want, the more it eludes us. Or we get what we think we want and we find out we didn't really want it in the first place. Everything that we go after will disappoint us. I don't think there's a whole lot of advantage in being terrifically assertive. I know very few people who are my age, and I'm like, say, edging ever so slightly toward 40. And I know a lot of people older than me, because there are, for those college kids, there are people older than 40. I've met a few. Very few of them ever found any real satisfaction in accomplishing anything. It's an amazing, remarkable thing that most people's satisfaction comes not from what they've accomplished, but from what happened as an actor. I love John Lennon, the John Lennon quote, where he says, life is what happens to you while you're busy making other plans. I think, wow, that is exactly true. We think that we're going to find happiness because we see something that happiness is supposedly contained in, and we go for it, and we get it, and we all live happily ever after. But that's not the way life works out, and even our own experiences tell us that. And yet we continue to be tolerant of a view of life that says nothing is more important in the world than that you get what you want. That is why there is so much hurt in the world. Because there are too many fathers that have decided that their kids cannot stand in the way of their going out and finding themselves. So they abandon their kids and they go out to find out who they really are. 20 years later, when their kids have grown up and don't know them, 20 years later when they've been through a couple more marriages with a couple younger women that were really not all that satisfying, when they're about 60 years old, they realize the folly of their thinking. They realize what a ridiculous and stupid thing it was. We do not find happiness by being assertive. We don't find happiness by running over other people because we see what we want and they are in the way of that happiness. So we either abandon them or we smash them. The scriptures don't teach us to be assertive. The scriptures teach us, and this is remarkable, the scriptures teach us to be submissive. This is not a popular idea for good reasons. Because this is a very hard route to take. Let me ask you this. Do you think David wanted to cut Goliath's head off? I think he did. I think he wanted to do that more than anything in the world. What 12-year-old boy wouldn't love to cut off a giant's head? Read your children's literature. Every great hero cuts off a giant's head. It's just like in Walt Disney movies, the bad guy always gets eaten by dogs. In children's fantasies, the hero always cuts off a bad guy's head, and it's always a much bigger guy than the hero. I'll bet David spent a great deal of his time that he's out there watching sheep. Have you ever watched sheep? Not much to look at. Young guy, he's out there. He's supposedly watching sheep, which he is kind of keeping an eye on him, but the whole time he is, in his imagination, slaughtering Philistines. Left and right. He's a good red-blooded Hebrew. He loves to kill Philistines. He lives for that. That gives meaning and shape to his dreams. And what a drag. His dad sends his brothers out to do that he's dreamed of doing all his life. And he's stuck at home watching sheep. What a bore. What a pathetic, tragic bore. I can just imagine that he probably, when he killed the lion, it probably wasn't even chasing the sheep. He was probably just throwing a tantrum. Oh, God. Pretending like that lion was his dad. When he killed the bear, probably wasn't exactly what he wanted to be doing. When David finally got to kill the giant, what did he really go out to do? Anybody know? How humiliating. He was taking sandwiches to his brothers. Here is a regular guy, wants to be a great soldier, wants to do great things. And his dad says, David, come in from the sheep. I've got a job for you. And I can see David getting really excited. He's going to send me to fight the Philistines. Because David doesn't know he's a little squirt. He goes in and his dad says, David, I want you to take these sandwiches to your brothers. How humiliating. So David takes the sandwiches to his brothers. When did David get to kill Goliath? He got to kill Goliath after he had taken the sandwiches to his brothers. Folks, when we learn to obey, when we learn to follow, we may become able to lead. But we are not going to be fit to lead until we are able to follow. When we learn to listen, after we have got the art of listening down, we are going to have something to say. But if we never learn to listen, we're going to talk, and never say a word. Everything in life is backwards from the way we think it's supposed to be. That was God's mean little joke that he played on us all. But that's okay. If he wants to have quirks, he can. He's God after all. And we can argue with him about it, but in the end, he's going to win anyway. So we may as well say, the Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away, blessed be the name of the Lord. Submitting is a drag. Submitting isn't particularly exciting. Submitting does not give us the psychological boost of having asserted ourselves. But in submitting, we find greater happiness than we do in asserting ourselves. Does that make sense to you? God wants to give you everything you need. You don't have to go out and steal it from anybody. You don't have to hurt anybody in order to accomplish it. God will provide that for you. Third thing the world tells us is that we're supposed to be independent. And I'll tell you what. If the truth is that the world is full of little gods, if the truth is that we all have reason to have faith in ourselves, if we are ultimately almighty people ourselves, and if everyone is going to be assertive, then the best thing in the world to do would be to be independent. Because in that kind of colossal struggle, there's going to be a lot of hurt going around. The Bible doesn't teach us to be independent. It's a very funny thing. The Bible teaches us to be interdependent. The Bible teaches us that we are a part of one body. That we are not little islands out there floating around being our own little gods and getting our own little ways. The Bible teaches that we are a part of a single body, which is the body of Christ. Apart from that body, we are not going to last long or live well. You may have a great finger, but if you cut that finger off from the rest of the body, it's not going to take it long to wither away and become nothing. If the world is full of little gods, and if the goal of their lives is to get their ways, independence is the wisest thing in the world. But if the world is full of people who ultimately trust that there is a God and that he does love them and he is concerned about them, and if out of that trust, out of that faith in Almighty God, we learn to submit ourselves to the authority that he has over us, to the authority of his scriptures, to the authority of our church, then we can begin to become interdependent. We don't have to be afraid of people. We don't have to be afraid that people are going to run over us. The world, you ever seen the movie Silverado? There's a line in there. What is her name? She's a really good actress. Hunter? No? Short lady. Linda Hunt? Linda Hunter. It's something like that. It's not Holly Hunter. Holly Hunter was in Broadcast News, right? Ooh, boy, I like that movie, too. Anyway, this lady, she's a very short lady, and in order to do her job as a bartender, she's standing behind the bar when you first see her, you know, serving up drinks, and just looks like a regular lady, and then she comes out from around the bar, and all of a sudden she's walking behind the bar, and you just see her head go until you can't see her anymore. She comes out from around the bar, and she's really incredibly short. And the guy who has gone into the bar, you know, one of the heroes of the story, looks at her with this kind of like look like, wow, I never would have guessed that you were like this. And she looks up at him and says, the world is what you make it. And I think that's partly true. I stole that line, wrote it into a song where I said, actually, I think Beaker's the one that suggested that we steal that line. Beaker's the one that always steals the line. I'm always the one that comes up with the original thought. Something about I wake in a world that I'm partly made of, in a world that is partly my own making. Folks, you get it. We are part of a society that does shape us. But this is the funny thing, is that you have an opportunity to shape that society back. You're not going to do it by getting along with everybody. There's going to be occasional friction because what you believe is just completely opposed to what our society believes. Our society values themselves. You have learned to value God. Our society believes in themselves. You've learned to believe in God. Our society says that they must assert themselves. You've learned that you can submit. Knowing that there is a God who wants to take care of your needs, it's no problem to submit to him. You don't have to run over people. You don't have to run out on people. You don't have to hurt people. Our society says that we have to be independent, that we have to be our own people. You've said, you know what? We can't be our own people because we are all part of one person. We're kind of diametrically opposed to our society. There is going to be friction. But through that friction, I think we can have an impact on it. I think that I'm not a Christian because I heard a concert. or because I read a good book, and I've gone to a lot of concerts, and I've read a lot of good books. The main reason why I became a Christian, and I came out of the world just like everybody else, but I became a Christian because I encountered the love of Christ and the people of his church. That changed me. I think we can change a lot of people. We can live in a world that is full of little gods who go around doing their own thing because they are their ultimate own authority. I love at the last U2 concert, at the Zoo TV concert, and they had all this just nonsense flashing around on the screens, and every now and again they would throw up a little slogan that was really brilliant. One of the slogans that they threw up that I thought, wow, I wish I could write this on the forehead of every teenager backwards so when they looked in the mirror they would see it. It said, when we are our own gods, everything is permissible. We live in a society that believes that we are all our own gods. Everything is permissible, and you can see what a mess things are in. We can continue to live in that society, or we can be a person who works toward being a group of people who believe that there is one supreme God and that he does reign, that his ways are right. We can continue to live in a society that says the only way to get what you want is to assert yourselves, and we can go along with that, or we can say, you know, the only way to get what you want is to submit yourself. We can continue to live in a society that demands that we all be independent and that we all be our own little islands and that we all live out our own little loneliness any way that we can figure out how to do, or we can say, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to be interdependent. I'm going to allow myself to become a part of a larger body, a body that is larger than me. I'm going to allow myself to need other people. I'm going to allow myself to be vulnerable with other people. I'm going to allow other people to need me. And I recognize that in the midst of all that, there's going to be some disappointment. I'm probably going to confide some stuff in people who probably can't handle my confidence. There are probably people who are going to need me, and I'm not always going to be able to be there for them when they think that I'm supposed to be. There are going to be disappointments, folks. But the overall result of believing in God, of being submissive, and allowing ourselves to be interdependent, what that ultimately comes to is a vital Christian life that is full of the Spirit and full of vitality. What believing in ourselves and asserting ourselves and being independent ultimately comes to is spiritual death. You get to make the choices. You get to pick the direction that you're going to go. We're going to talk in the next three sessions about three areas of need. We're going to talk, and it's very interesting because in the stuff that you guys brought up when we were asking you, what do you think we need? You said, you said what you said had to do with all three of these. One thing that we need is purpose in life, which we'll talk about work. In that, someone brought up work. I was very pleased to hear that. Not a lot of people think we need work. Another thing that we're going to talk about that we need is the need for rightness. We live in a world that says there is no such thing as right and wrong. There's only power, and power is always displayed in lobby groups. Well, it doesn't really matter what the lobbyists want. There is still such a thing as right and wrong. Someday there will be a judgment. I hope God is merciful to all of us. Third thing that we're going to talk about that we need is love, which was the one thing that you guys said in a million different ways, a million different words for the same thing. I get the feeling that we need a lot of love in this world. And what we're going to try to demonstrate in all three of those things is this, and this is the key statement for the weekend, and this is what you need to take down and remember, even if you forget everything else that is said. That our needs are met through faith in God and not through our own striving. If you have a notebook and you have a pen, you might want to write that down, because before this is all over, you'll be expected to have that memorized. There will be a quiz. Our needs are met through faith in God and not by our own striving.
Did anybody write that down? What is it? Very good. You get an A. Anybody else? Get it written down? Yes, can you quote it for me? Anybody else? You're just not raising your hands because you don't want me to make you say it by yourself. Oh, here's a brave soul. Okay, can I hear this whole section? Repeat that. Just repeat after me. Our needs are met through faith in God and not by our own striving. Pretty good. Let me hear you guys over here. Our needs are met.
You are few, but you are mighty.
Our needs are met.
Through faith in God.
Through faith in God.
And not by our own striving.
And not by our own striving.
You guys, our needs are met.
Our needs are met.
What is the need?
Our needs are met.
Our needs are met.
Through faith in God.
Through faith in God.
And not by our own striving.
And not by our own striving.
Okay, I want to hear everybody say, 1, 2, 3, our needs are met.
Our needs are met.
Through faith in God.
Through faith in God.
And not by our own striving. I want to tell you one more story before I go. How many of you've read all the Gospels, right? And the Synoptic Gospels, there's a very interesting thing, that each one of them have two stories back to back. One is the story of Jesus blessing the children. And the very next story in all three of the Synoptic Gospels is the story of the rich young ruler. Now, when we put the story all together, how does it come out? Jesus is blessing the children, and what happens? And I'm figuring, you know, how do you bless children? Because I was thinking about this as I was reading the book. I went, well, how do you bless children? And, you know, I'm trying to think, was he, like, sprinkling them with water? Was he making the sign of the cross? What was he doing with these kids? And I thought, well, you know, Mark gives us a clue. It says that he had put his arms around these children. I was going, yeah, that's probably, I mean, I always felt blessed as a little kid when my uncles would give me a big old hug, or they'd throw me up in the air and catch me right before I splatted. You know, I got nieces and nephews, and, you know, you get down on all four, and you let them ride on your back, and you try to buck them off, and they hang on, and, you know, then they hit their head and cry for their mom. They feel really blessed when that's all over. So anyway, Jesus flew around like this, and the disciples come in, and what do they say to him? What are you doing? You're a big figure. You're a very important guy. What are you fooling around with these kids for? And what does Jesus say to the disciples? Right. Hey, lay off, fellas. Unless you come to me like one of these children, unless you become like one of these children, you'll never come into my kingdom. And then the rich young ruler comes up and asks the stupidest question in the Bible, which is why I love this question, because it really is inane. What was the rich young ruler's question? Good master, what? What must I do to be saved? Why is that a stupid question? I'll bet right now the rich young ruler is up in heaven just blushing. Why is it a stupid question? Because you can't do anything. And what else? Jesus had just got done, and in Mark, once again, we go to Mark, and Mark says, as he was leaving on his journey, the rich young man came up to him and asked him this. Jesus, who is God, had just got done saying, unless you become like a child, unless you receive my kingdom as a child receives it, you will in no way enter the kingdom of heaven. And this rich young guy, I can tell he was running for office. And this was his big photo op, because Christ was a pretty popular figure at that time. And so the whole time Jesus is talking, he was probably a college student running for office, because he was doing what all college students do. He was thinking of a great question to ask the prof for when the lecture is over. Through the whole lecture, he's sitting there going, what could I ask him? What would really make me look great? So Jesus gets up from giving the answer. He starts on his way, and the rich young man asks a very stupid question, what must I do? Well, the story goes on from there. Ultimately, Jesus tells him to get rid of everything that he's ever done. Very interesting the way Christ talks to people in the Bible. Christ only told one man that he should be born again, and it was Nicodemus. Why do you think he told Nicodemus that he should be born again, and he didn't tell anybody else to be born again? I think this, because I think Nicodemus had a lot of confidence and a lot of faith in his national heritage, in the fact that he was Jewish and that the Jewish people were chosen by God. And I think Nicodemus' whole sense of who he was wrapped up in Judaism. And I think Christ was saying, you know what? I don't want you to identify with Abraham. I want you to recognize that you must be born again. You must come to a new identity.
you must come to a new center of your person. Christ told the rich young ruler to get rid of everything he had. Not only was this shocking to the rich young ruler, this was shocking to all the apostles, because in their way of thinking, they had all gone to the same churches that you see on TV, where if you're a good Christian, if you're a spiritually vital person, you drive a good car, you have a pretty countenance, and you always feel good about yourself, your kids always feel good about you, your neighbors always feel good about you, you're always healthy, you never suffer. You've never read that psalm that talks about people who do that. The disciples say, well, if this is the case, if the rich, if the people who accomplish great things in this life can't be saved, then who can be saved? And what does Jesus say? I love this. He says, with man, it is impossible. But with God, nothing is impossible. Folks, our needs are not met because we are great enough to have them met. What I hope you can go away from this weekend realizing is this, is you have a Father who loves you so desperately and loves you so totally and loves you so completely that he knows what you need beyond what you even recognize. He already knows what you need. And he is pleased to meet those needs. And it may not look like what you think it's going to look like. But your Father loves you very much. And you can go through your life with a great confidence, not because you're great, but because you have a Father who is great. And you can come to know the fullness of life, not because you go out and go for the gusto, but because you submit yourself to the one who loves you so. That you can have real relationships with people, not because you are your own independent person, but because he knits us together as one body. Our needs are met through faith in God and not by our own striving. Repeat that again with me. Ready? Let's try the whole first phrase. Our needs are met through faith in God.
Our needs are met through faith in
God. And not by our own striving.
You're
starting to catch on, but I want you to do this. I want you to stand up. I want you to put everything on the floor. And I want you to just pretend like you're at a holy roller meeting. I want you to put your hands up in the air. I want you to kind of go like this a little bit. And I want you to go, our needs are met.
Our needs are met.
Through faith in God.
Through faith in God.
And not by our own striving.
And not by our own striving.
Very good. I want you to get down on your knees. And I want you to put your hand into your little hands. Your hand into your hands. I want you to put your face in your hands. I want you to be good Quakers, what I'm asking you to do. Get down and very quietly, I want you to whisper. This is hard, but I'm hoping to warm you up. I want you to whisper very quietly, very Quaker-like, our needs are met through faith in God and not by our own striving. Okay, now I just want you to sit down on your chair. I want you to look at your neighbor. I want you to look him straight in the eye and say, your needs are met through faith in God. And not by your own striving.
I'll be your neighbor.
Okay, now I want you to look straight ahead and I want you to say in one phrase to me, our needs are met through faith in God and not by our own striving.
Our needs are met through faith in God and not by our own striving.
Thank you very much for coming out. I think we're going to wrap up there because I think we're supposed to be out of here by 9. Is that right? Okay, I'll tell you what. We're supposed to be out of here by 10, right? Like I said, hey, it's been a long day for me too. Let's take about a 15-minute break, and you will find out in the course of this weekend that Beeger and I are both real stinkers about time. Promptitude is everything. Promptitude is next to godliness. I don't know if you had a grandma or not, but I did. And she taught me that well. We will start. We're gonna just hang out for a little bit. I want to get to meet some of you guys that I haven't got to meet. And then at 25 till, we'll be back in our seats and we'll do some more singing and some more goofing around, okay? And maybe we'll see what you guys want to do. So if you need to go to the bathroom, who's the guy that knows where the bathroom is? Who's the guy that? Would you please stand up? Some people came in late. They didn't. This is the guy who can lead you to the promised land. So let's, it's 25 after. So, we're not going to go till 10, but we're going to take a 15-minute break here anyway. So, get up, move around, and then we'll start up another thing pretty smartly. We have time to field just a couple questions. So if you have a question about the last session or like if you need something to be clarified a little bit, we have time for just a little bit of that. We don't want to spend a lot of time doing that. Because I'll tell you what, it is not important that you agree with this. Okay? Because the honest truth is, I know less now than I did when we first started doing this. I keep getting more and more confused. But I think that it doesn't hurt to think things out, and I'd really like to challenge you to do that. Yes, you had a question. You know, we get asked that a lot, and we never know what to say. I guess when we were working this all out, and we got down to, well, what are we really trying to talk about here? What are we really trying to say? And we said, okay, here is the key statement. This is the heart of the whole thing. Our needs are met through faith in God and not by our own striving. Because we wanted to talk about why people make wrong choices. We were specifically, I think, looking at teenagers and the way that we think we're going to find satisfaction in a lot of things that don't really bring satisfaction. We were going, okay, so there's what you need and what you want because you think that what you want is going to give you what you think you need. And then we end up settling for a lot of really dumb stuff. And we'll get into all that tomorrow. Only to find out that a lot of the parents that you know, were sponsors of the youth groups that were coming were going, you know what, that really, you were really speaking to me more. I think we got more out of it than the kids. And going, you know what, I think I get more out of it every time I do it than the people who have to endure my doing it. But we got down to the very heart of it. And we're going, well, what are we really saying? And we said, well, what we're really saying is our needs are met through faith in God and not by our own striving. And we went, no one's going to buy that. No one's going to believe that. We at the time, we didn't even really believe it. And we just really started looking at it and then trying to apply that. And I'll tell you what, it is a lot easier to talk about than it is to live. It is really, you know, believe it or not, I've said almost the exact same thing that I just said up here a few minutes ago. I said that probably a couple hundred times. I can get the words out. I stutter no matter how, you know, I this is just the way I talk. I can say it very easily, but I can't always believe it. It's very easy for me to tell you that there is a God and that he really does love you. It's not always easy for me to believe that. I guess when I look at the alternatives, it's just hard for me to believe that the world is as it is and that there is no God. I kind of go, when I look at DNA, when I look at the terrific amount of engineering it takes for our eyes to be able to focus, when I think about gravity, the chances of that being an accident would require such a leap of faith for me to take. I'm just not willing. I just don't have that much faith. It's just easier for me to believe that there is a designer and that we are the result of his design. And I follow that all the way out. I kind of go, I've either got to make a leap and believe that there really is a God and he really does love us and he really has revealed himself in Christ, or I have to choose to believe something else. And it's really easier to believe in God as he has revealed himself to us in Christ than it is to believe any of the other stuff that people have come up with. So, did that answer your question? Did I even address your question? This is the great thing about, you know, because you have to do radio interviews all the time. And HME, the super people here, I really do like them. In fact, I'm friends with a couple of them, pretty close friends with a couple of them. But a lot of times you go out and you do these really, you know, you have to deal with some real geek DJs, you know. They ask you these really retarded questions. For years, ever since I wrote Awesome God, people go, I still can't believe. Radio DJs still go, okay, so how did you write Awesome God? You know, like there's a big story behind it. Look, buddy, it's a lot of hard work. This stuff doesn't come about by an accident. Well, what was the inspiration? The inspiration was I was driving on my way to Colorado, and I was very sleepy, and I had to stay awake, so I rolled down my window and pretended like I was a Baptist. And Awesome God is what happened. It's not a particularly inspiring story. You know, and then their mouth drops open because they know they expect me to say, well, you know, I was fasting and in prayer, and suddenly the Holy Spirit came down, and there was like tongues of fire. You know, no, the actual honest truth is, life is so much more spectacular than spectacular stuff. And just good, honest work is a lot more holy and amazing than a whole lot of ecstatic kind of religious experiences. So that still didn't answer your question, did it? But I did. So these guys ask you these really dweeby questions. And I used to actually try to answer their questions, but what I've learned now is, like, they will ask me, how did you write Awesome God? And I'll say, I just say whatever I want to say. Your question was, how did we come up with this? Where did we get this junk from? Just from being around young people and saying, why did I make the stupid choices that I made? And why do people make the dumb choices that they make? And how can we learn to look at our lives and to say, here's the mark, here's the bullseye, and here's the ballpark, and here's the kind of you're off the target altogether kind of thing. Because I think generally most people in their lives end up settling for a lot of stuff because they give up on really having what we really need in our lives and even what we really want. Another question that I can't answer? Yes. I think the reason why there's a negative attitude about submission is because a lot of authority has been very negative authority. To the place where I'm in a religion class at Friends University, and I got really bad post-nasal drip too. So I'm up here choking. I think a lot of people think that authority is asserting, is that a very assertive person is a very authoritative person. Like, for example, the classic picture of the dad who comes home from work and demands that the house be quiet and that his paper be here and that his slippers be set out by the chair and all that kind of thing. And a lot of people have called that authority, so that a lot of other people have a very bad opinion of authority. I don't think that a very demanding, very bossy person is really a good example of authority. I think real authority, the kind of authority that we should experience in the church, and I got to tell you the truth, I don't know that we always experience this kind of authority in the church or anywhere else, but I think real, godly, good authority is the kind of authority that is nourishing. It's the kind of authority that would have the same attitude that John the Baptist had, where he said, I must become less and he must become more. I think real, genuine authority is the kind of authority that enables a person to need it less and less. Does that make sense? And I think because in our experience of it, so often authority has been damaging. So often there have been, you know, there are so many cases where authority has been a very negative thing in a lot of people's lives, that it's almost hard for us to imagine that there could be an eldership that really was concerned about your spiritual wealth and your spiritual health and well-being. Does that make sense? And so we've become very, very suspicious. And maybe a little bit of suspicion is a good thing. I think being able to submit is I think it's really, really hard. And I think that's why so many of us give up even trying. But I think that, and frequently I get asked this question only in real specifics, like people say, my dad or my mom or someone is involved in drug trafficking and they're expecting me to carry drugs for them. Am I supposed to submit to them? And I kind of go, this is way beyond what I'm able to answer. You really need to talk to someone that can help you. And I'm not that person. But I think there is kind of a, like, authority kind of thing. I think that God obviously is the highest authority. But I think that the problem with saying that is that we all have our own take on what God is really like. And so I think that God, as he is defined in the scriptures and in the church, that would have to be a pretty high authority. Parental authority, of course, comes into it because Jesus himself upholds the idea of parental authority. The other thing that I think amazing is that everybody will submit to some authority, whether it's the authority of your parents or the authority of your church or the authority of your boss or the authority of your peers. Everybody submits. And I think a great example is when you see a bunch of high school or college age people, or even adults, professional people, they all tend to dress very much the way that their peers expect them to dress. Their peers dictate to them what they're supposed to wear. They submit to their peers, the danger of that being that their peers are just as stupid as they are. The advantage of having parents that you can submit to is your parents have already been through the fashion wars and know that nobody really wins. So they have a little more sense about them. So, yes. And okay, and she brings up a real good point. What happens when your government, and I think we'll see this increasingly, what happens when your government demands that you do things that you know are contrary to the will of God? And I would say, from what I can understand in the scriptures, is that you must obey God rather than men. And when there's a conflict of authorities, you always go with the higher authority. And if it comes down to being obedient to God or obeying Hillary, I'm going to go with God. I would go with a Dalmatian over Hillary, though, so that's not really all that. Good. Send it to her. Yes. But I think that boldness, and we will discuss this later on tomorrow, so I don't want to go into that a whole lot, but I think that there is a difference. Living in Wichita is a very interesting thing because, the pro-life movement is very, very strong out there. Beaker and I have both been involved in that, and it's really been an exciting place to live. It's really, I really feel so much more really American for having gone to jail. I think any decent person who needs to go to jail in our society, and I feel like we have a great heritage in this country of civil disobedience, but that disobedience does not demonstrate itself in a rebellious, I'll show you, you son of a gun kind of attitude. It's much more a, I know you're going to beat the living daylights out of me, but I cannot move. And I'm not doing this just to be repugnant. I'm doing this because you're making a big mistake. And I will bear the brunt. And this is part of taking up your cross, is that you will bear the brunt of the violence of the world as a Christian. And you have to take those stripes and you have to take that violence, absorb it into yourself, and walk on. And it's not an easy thing to do. Yes.
I was thinking, just along with your, the whole submission thing, because you kind of talked about authority some, and I just think there are opportunities every day, all the time, to be submissive when we choose not. I mean, I just go, we can think of a lot of things where there might be hard questions, with issues with our government. You can trace all the way back, should we pay our taxes? And I, I mean, I, for one, I kind of like rebellion a little bit. And, I mean, I go, if the whole picketing abortion clinics doesn't work anymore, if people really want to be rebellious, just stop paying your taxes. That would be the thing that would take it. But that's a whole nother point. What I'm saying is as far as submission goes, every day when we're around other people, there's opportunities, I think, to be submissive. And it comes down to a question of wills sometimes. And then you go through, how do we interplay with people? And we do all kinds of things in order not to be submissive. We might lay guilt on them. We might do a quiet game. We might do a yelling game. We can do whatever and whatever. But the point is I believe that we would get along better with our children. We would get along better with our spouses, with our siblings, with our parents, if everyone would submit. If everyone could say, you know what? What I want ain't the most important thing. It might be what this other person wants or needs. And I don't know. That might just be a real simple, stupid thing about submission. That's just the way I see it. It saves lots of arguments, saves lots of hurt feelings. Anyway, oh well.
Yes.
Okay. The question is, how does a wife submit to her husband if her husband is abusive, and that sort of thing? And I don't know how to answer that question. I just would recommend that you talk to the elders of your church and get their guidance on it. Talk to some older, mature Christian women who have been there. I know I come from a family that was, you know, every family I think is pretty dysfunctional, but as dysfunctional families go, mine was pretty good. So I really have no experience there, and I'm not afraid of the question. I think it's a real serious question, but I have no idea how to answer that. I think you might be wrong there. I think that if you were a Muslim, you would look at the way Christian men treat their wives, and you would go, wow, they've got it all over us. So I think, you know, Christian men are not as bad as we're made out to be. But I don't know. This is only my experience. I've had great experience with Christian men, but I couldn't say for sure. I really would recommend, you know, that you talk to if any of you women have been in that same situation, you know, this is a good place for that, because you're pretty safe. You're probably not going to see each other from here on out. You can bury your souls and walk away feeling pretty good. Another question? We have time for just one more. Oh, you bring up a great point. I think the balance is this. I think that self condemnation is just negative self adulation. Anytime that I think that I am so good and that I am so cool and so groovy and so powerful that I can pull myself up by my own bootstraps, I have an exaggerated view of myself, of my goodness. Anytime I think I am so bad and so negative and so rotten and so nasty and so horrible that God could never love me, I have an exaggerated view of my sin. I'm suffering from delusions of grandeur about how bad I am. No, you're just not that bad. Does that make sense? So my thing is not to say that we don't need to believe in ourselves means we don't need to condemn ourselves. We don't need to praise ourselves. If we had a lot of time, the thing that I would most recommend would be that we forget ourselves. That rather than worry about how good or how bad we are, that we just don't worry. that we get to know the names of the trees in our neighborhoods, that we get to find out what shingles are made out of. There are a million things in the world that we can think about that have nothing to do with ourselves, and I think we'd be healthier if we would like not be self-condemning and not be self-adulating. If we would just went, let's just realize God sees me as I can't see myself. And God has created a wonderful world for me to live in. I need to go out and celebrate God in everything that I can see, everything that I can hear, everything I can taste, everything I can feel, everything I can experience. And forget about yourself altogether. We got to move on because we're running out of time. We're going to do a couple songs, but yes. Uh-huh. Well. All right. It's still a question I don't really have an answer for. We'll do a couple songs. Anybody have a request? Step by step. This is a song. I don't know if you guys know how this was written, but Beaker wrote the chorus to this in a hotel room in Midland, Texas. And we put the chorus on the first album, on the first World as Best as I Remember It. But why don't you use mine? So after we put it on the first album, I was so jealous that I didn't get to write on it. I fooled Beaker into thinking that we needed to have verses for this song so that I could help write the verses. It was a mean trick, but it worked. And this, of course, works a lot better if you all sing, so. Sometimes the night was beautiful. Sometimes the sky was so far away. Sometimes it seemed to stoop so close. You could touch it, but your heart would break. Sometimes the morning came too soon. Sometimes the day could be so hot. There was so much work left to do. So much you'd already done. Oh God, you are my God. And I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God. And I will ever praise you. And I will seek you in the morning. And I will learn to walk in your ways. And step by step. Sometimes I think of Abraham and how one star he saw had been lit just for me. He was a stranger in this land, and I am that no less than he. And on this road to righteousness, some climb can be so steep. I may falter in my steps, but never beyond your reach. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. And I will seek you in the morning. And I will learn to walk in your ways. And step by step you'll lead me.
And I will follow you all of my days. And I will follow you all of my days. And I will follow you all of my days. And step by step you lead me. And I will follow you all of my days.
What?
Let's see.
Do you know all the words? Who said that?
I know a funny story about this song. This friend of mine was in a drama troupe one time, and they wanted him to sing. Anyway, he's in this drama troupe, and they wanted the drama troupe to sing during the church service, and none of them were singers. But is there no piano at all out there? So he said, we're not really good singers. They got out to sing, you know. We're not really good singers, but we just want you to listen to the words of the song because we think that's what's important. And they went, holy, holy, holy. They sang all four verses of it that way. Does anybody know all these, all the words of this? Can you come up and help lead? Why do people always disappear when they know the answers? But you know enough, you can lead a little bit, right?
I'm in E-flat. Let me take it that way.
Did you guys know we are climbing Jacob's ladder? We are climbing Jacob's ladder. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. So every round goes higher, higher.
And every round goes higher and higher. Every round goes higher. soldiers of the cross.
Sinner, do you know my Jesus?
Do you know my Jesus? Sinner, do you know my Jesus? Sinner, do you know my Jesus? Soldiers of the Soldiers of the cross.
Anybody know what that song is about? I have no idea. I have never known it. I just know it's really a beautiful song. If I stand, okay. Now we'll be doing most of these songs in a concert tomorrow night, so... Yeah, you can go to the bathroom during this song tomorrow night because you will have already heard it tonight. And you can sing along because I really one of the great thrills for me is when people sing along in a concert. And most other performers that I talk to feel the same way because you kind of go, you know, you write songs because they speak to you. And but you're hoping the whole time you write them that they're going to speak to somebody else too. Because you hope you're not the only weirdo out there. And it's very affirming when you find out that other people go, oh, yeah, I've thought that too. So, there's more that rises in the morning than the sun. And more that shines in the night than just the moon. It's more than just this fire here that keeps me warm. And a shelter that is larger than this room. There's a loyalty that's deeper than mere sentiments, and the music higher than the songs that I can sing. The stuff of earth competes for the allegiance I owe only to the giver of all good things. So if I stand, let me stand on the promise that you will pull me through. If I can't, let me fall on the grace that first brought me to you. And if I sing, let me sing for the joy that is born in me, these songs. And if I weep, let it be as a man who is longing for his home. There's more that dances on these prairies than the wind, more that pulses in the ocean than the tide. And there's a love that is fiercer than the love between friends, more gentle than a mother's when there's a baby at her side. There's a loyalty that's deeper than mere sentiments, and the music higher than the songs that I can sing. The stuff of earth competes for the allegiance I owe only to the giver of all good things. So if I stand, let me stand on the promise that you will pull me through. And if I can't, let me fall on the grace that first brought me to you. And if I sing, let me sing for the joy that is born in me, these songs. And if I weep, let it be as a man who is longing for his home. And if I weep, let it be as a man who is longing for.
What? Oh, it's in G. Is that when Amy recorded it or when I did it? Oh, that's right. In piano, I can play in three keys. Na, 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 na. Let's see. How does the chorus go? You can thank the Father for the things he's done. You can thank what he's going to do. That's a little high. So it must be. Oh, I got to tell you a funny story about this song, too, is that Amy Grant decided to record this. I was playing out at her house. We were going over songs, and I was playing this before I went. Oh, because at the time I was engaged, and I said, you know, well, I wrote this song for my wedding, which actually never happened, thank God. And so she said, oh, I really like that. I really want to record it. Well, that was, nothing more was said. And then they went into the studio to do her next album, and I, of course, wasn't around, and they couldn't remember how the song went. Oh, and she had it all on this little tape player, which, you know, you think Amy Grant, you're going, okay, you probably go in her house, and she's got this fabulous tape deal. No, she had this crummy little cassette tape. You know, and she couldn't figure out what buttons to hold down to get it to record and stuff. So anyway, they had this tape, and Brown Bannister was producing at the time, and he got the music off of it and everything, and that was all great. But they couldn't understand my lyrics because I sing even worse then than I do now. And so they finally got a hold of me and said, please get us. And this was before faxes. We've got to have the lyrics tomorrow. So I had to, like, FedEx. So I was in a real hurry, and I wrote them down as fast as I could. Well, my writing was so bad. They still couldn't make out the words. So she recorded it wrong. Bless her heart. And you know what bless your heart means? If you're, that's Southerner's way of saying, gosh, you're stupid. Yeah, because they never say, he's a real hero, bless his heart. They always say, well, he tries real hard, bless his heart. Anyway, so she's saying, if you see the moon rising gently on your fields, well, what a stupid line, because obviously the song is about time going in a circle. So you would have to start with morning if you're going to end up with night. But, you know, that's why Amy is making a mere several million dollars a year, and I'm here with you. And if you find the morning rising gently on your fields, and if the wind blows softly on your face, and if the sunset lingers while cathedral bells peal, till the moon has risen into place, well, you can thank the Father for the things that he has done. But thank him for the things he's yet to do. And if you find someone who's tender, and if you find a love that's true, then thank the Lord, he's been doubly good to you. If you look in the mirror at the long end of a long day, and you know in your heart you have not lied, and if you gave love freely, and if you earned an honest wage, and if you got Jesus by your side, you can thank the Father for the things that he has done. For the things he's yet to do. And if you find someone who's tender, and if you find a love that's true, then thank the Lord, he's been doubly good to you. And you can thank the Father for the things that he has done. I thank him for the things he's yet to do. And if you find someone who's tender, and if you find a love that's true, then thank the Lord. I thank the Lord. He's been doubly good to you. Hey, another funny story about that is this friend of mine, this another writer down in Nashville, she was just shocked at how awful that song was, especially considering that I've never been one of those people who bought into the prosperity teachings. You know, I've always